Bryce, when did you start thinking about winning this award? Very young or recently? How can you describe that?
Winning the award, honestly, never. You know, it's always a dream, you know, where it's just, it's, you know, the award speaks for itself. You always know about it. You know, it's always a dream. But then, like, ironically, when I'm, you know, when you're actually a college, you know, you're actually a college football player, you know, it's actually a possibility. That's probably when I thought about it the least. For me, it was all about winning and all about doing whatever was best for the team. And honestly, I will say that is one of the big reasons why I went to Alabama. One of the big reasons why, you know, Alabama was the best choice for me was I knew I would never have to think, worry about individual accolades or individual awards or whatever. All I had to do was what I, you know, originally wanted to do and always have been doing is thinking about the team and trying to win. And at a place like Alabama, when you get to play against the best and compete with and against the best, you know, individual stuff kind of comes on its own. It's not something you have to focus about. And, you know, for me, you know, this is, you know, being here is a huge honor, a huge blessing. It means a lot to me. But at the end of the day, the ultimate goal for me is, you know, for us to reach our, as a team, to reach our ultimate goal, and that, you know, is to keep winning.
What are some of the things you learned about yourself on the field during the season and off the field?
Yeah, I think this was a big year for me to grow and to get better. I'd say on the field, I really just learned how important communication was for me and for everyone on the field, making sure that we're all on the same page. And, you know, I have a great group of guys around me, and, you know, whenever I've realized really a big, you know, a big catalyst for our success is when we're communicating a lot. We're always on the same page. We're talking through everything. And I've noticed how important that is. You know, the college operation, to make sure that you're always on the same page, make sure you're communicating. And then off the field, really I'd say it's just understanding, you know, just really understanding more about, you know, about just life in general and about, you know, what that means as a college student, as a football player, how to navigate it. You know, as a college student, you know, for me, I'm still, I like to say relatively young. And, you know, you take steps in life. There's a lot that you learn on the field, but, you know, just as for me as a sophomore, there's just stuff that happens, and, you know, as a college student in your personal life, stuff like that, you know, is probably a little more private, but was definitely a learning experience for me.
Do you have a game day routine, Bryce?
Yeah, they type it out for us every day on game day. We all have the same regimen, but you know, there's like a as far as on the field, there's definitely a warm up that I do before every game. There's, you know, we kind of have a similar routine as far as, you know, when we go to eat, when we leave the hotel, you know, time in between of watching whatever last bit of summary film that night, you know, before you leave the hotel. But, you know, as far as, you know, there's just more so stuff on the field that I say more religiously repeat, just to make sure that I'm warm and everything. But outside of that, you know, I trust our staff that, you know, puts me in there too.
What's your relationship with Coach O'Brien, and how does he coach you? Meaning, is he a person that will speak to you, or are you a person that takes to someone being boisterous, you know, loud? Or can you explain that?
That's my guy. I mean, him coming in, you know, honestly, when he first got the job and first got announced as being ROC, I didn't, you know, I had never met him, I never talked to him, and I was doing this like mad dash of research, and, like, you know, what is he, you know, what do people say, what is he, you know, what is he like? And I was trying to call people that I knew, and, you know, everyone was like, yeah, he's cool, he's good. I was like, all right, that sounds good. And really what I knew going in was, you know, obviously his last job, being head coach and GM. And I knew the greats that he had coached, Coach Brady. You know, he coached so many, you know, has such a rich coaching history. And, you know, I wasn't sure what to expect. And really the biggest thing was when I first met him, it was crazy for the coaching, for the people that he coached and the places that he's coached and the success he had. It was crazy how humble he was and how willing to work with me he was. And, you know, you kind of have to build that trust. You know, you have to build that mutual trust in that relationship as you get comfortable with each other, and that came throughout the offseason. But during the season, there's so much, you know, discussion. It gives me so much say in what to do, you know, and what calls I like, what calls I don't. If there's a play player I want to put in or I look I want to put in, he's always, his door is always open. And, you know, we have such a good relationship to where we can talk about, you know, we can talk about stuff off the field, on the field, and we can talk about any, you know, he's always open to change. He's always talking about, you know, he does it. If he loves a play and I don't like it, he won't call me. You know, he only wants to call the plays I want to call, and he understands, you know, kind of the importance of that for the quarterback position. And again, for someone who's had such a rich coaching history that he's had, and to coach the guy he's coached, he could have easily came in and just said, yeah, you have no say, just sit back, I'm gonna call the plays, I'm gonna do this, and you're just gonna listen. But instead, he chose to come in and for us to have dialogue, be able to talk about stuff. You know, every time he puts something in, he explains and makes sure I get it. And that, he didn't have to do that. And, you know, that meant a lot for me. And Tabo is my most, it's been amazing.
Have you watched Kenny Pickett at all this year?
I haven't in depth, like, broken down. Obviously, you see stuff you see highlights and stuff. But I did watch, what game was it that I watched that Pitt played? Was it Art? I watched one game that we had a mutual opponent. I watched one game.
Tennessee.
And yeah, you can tell it was a really popped on film too. That was like, you kind of get familiar with like the SEC quarterbacks because you watch them like every week based off. So I just had that one game, so I didn't have as much familiarity. But from that one game, you could tell how much he popped on film. You could tell, and that was even earlier in the year. But you can tell that he was a special player. You can tell how much he popped on film. You can tell how good he looked. He's really good defense. So that was one chance I really got to kind of where you're breaking stuff down, and he just jumped off the screen.
During the Auburn game, when the running back went out, when they were trying to run out the clock and went out of bounds, was there talk at all among on the sidelines or in the huddle of like, oh, they screwed up, we're going to go make them pay for it?
A little bit, yeah. I kind of did some math in my head on the sideline when I saw that, and I was thinking, with that, it's like, oh, like, well, I know our defense is going to, you know, I have deep faith in our defense. I know our defense is going to get a stop. And we all kind of looked at each other on the sideline and was like, hey, like, make sure we're ready. We're going to have, you know, we're going to have time. We're going to have all the time we need. We're going to have opportunity. And, you know, that was kind of, you know, just logistically seeing with that, and then, you know, seeing the timeouts we had with Matt, like, we learned that this is great time for a two-minute drive. So for us, we all were kind of on the sideline knowing we're going to get that one last chance. And again, that's kind of when that confidence and faith started.
I guess two questions. How confident were you that you could be this good in your first year as a starter coming in? And what did the Georgia, the championship game, mean to you in the sense that you played so well, and but they had such a good defense? How satisfying is
that? I think, you know, you have to have confidence in yourself to play at this level and to, you know, be successful. So I don't think the confidence ever wavered, and really it came from, for me, the confidence comes from work that you put in offseason, work that you put in, during the season, whatever it is, and, you know, seeing the people around you, seeing how hard my teammates work, seeing how hard the coaches work, and, what goes in, the ins and outs that, you know, not everyone gets to see. So through all that, you know, that's really where my confidence comes from, as far as, you know, the SEC championship against Georgia. It was a huge moment for us as a team, huge moment for me. And, you know, to play, anytime you get to play in a conference championship, you get to play for SEC championship, it means a lot. For it to be against such a storied program, like Georgia, for it to be such a great team, such a great defense, and for us to have the success we did, it means a lot. It was big for us. Obviously, we knew it was kind of a deep win situation for us, so we understood the magnitude of it. But at the same time, it was great. There's stuff that we did well that we want to build off of, and stuff we didn't do so well that we have to clean up. But at the same time, we understand, any win in the past isn't going to help us with anything in the future. You build off of what you did positive, and then you grow from what you didn't do as well, and you kind of filed in. You kind of chalk it up like that, and then you have to turn it around. So for us, it was great while it lasted, but that's not going to help us in the future. We have to continue to work hard. We have to push ourselves, and it's going to take everything for us to win our next game. So, for us, that's all that matters.
Bryce, C.J. Stroud was talking about your guys' relationship growing up, high school and whatnot. What do you remember about meeting him and kind of, he was under the radar for a lot of his recruitment. What do you remember about him as a quarterback and kind of his development and becoming what he has at Ohio State?
I've been knowing CJ for a minute now. It's crazy because high school, it just took him, like, he was a little later to, like, as far as getting, you know, all the rankings or whatever and all the offers. And, it was nationally, he kind of popped up a little later if you're not from around the area. But for me, someone who's been around him a lot, and, you know, obviously being in SoCal, just knowing kind of the landscape of, you know, everyone that was around there in general, like, it was kind of new to everyone else, I'd say. But, like, for me, I had seen him. He's been, you know, he's been performing like that. And he's been a great player like that for as long as I know. So it was kind of just, you know, it was something that, you know, for whatever reason, it just, I guess it took later in everyone else's eyes. But for me, I've known the type of player he is, the type of person he is. That's someone I'm super close with on and off the field. It wasn't really a surprise to me. It was kind of just like everyone else is kind of, you know, everyone else kind of tripping for a second, and then he ended up catching up. Everything working out, but to be able to kind of, you know, be able to share this weekend with him and for us to both be here, it's super special.
He mentioned the game you guys played against each other. Do you remember that game?
I don't know. You don't even have to tell me what he said about it. We kind of remember it a little differently, but good for CJ, man. I'm gonna let him have it. You know, whatever he said.
He said you guys won big.
Then he must be talking about. All right, he must be talking about. He must be talking about that game. Oh yeah, then that's probably like he said, it's super accurate. All right. We were just talking about some of the basketball not too long ago. But regardless, again, whenever you're able, with CJ, again, that's someone that I have the utmost respect for. And seeing him, us kind of growing together, and seeing him, seeing kind of how far both of us have came, and seeing, and just knowing him and knowing how he's grown and developed as a player, as a person, that's someone I'm super happy for. And he's an amazing player, amazing person, amazing defender, everything. So I'm happy to share this with him.
Right. So you think back to your dad was talking about you were five and he was bringing you to a quarterback coach, and like some of the other kids were 8, 9, 10, 11 years old. You think back on that, did you feel at all out of place? Did you realize at that time, oh, I must be pretty good if I'm five and I'm playing with 9 or 10 year olds? What was that like for you at that age?
Yeah, I wouldn't say out of place. I felt kind of like with that and just my personality, I was kind of just always around little people. And I guess that kind of just throughout experience kind of just became more natural. And it was just, for me, it was just a great opportunity to challenge myself. I've always felt kind of pushed to just try to be around the best, try to push myself to be the best version of myself. And to do that, you know, you have to try to surround yourself with people, that challenge you. And, my dad's kind of someone who told me, helped instill that into me. And, it was funny because at that age, kind of nowadays, that's kind of, that's more and more common. People started way younger. But at that time, it was like crazy. My dad was getting all this like backlash. And like, people were like, what are you doing? You're having this, kid. He's so young and he's working with all these older people. And for me, it was kind of normal. That was just what I was used to. And again, you start to kind of see it catch on now and be more normalized. But back then, it was like this crazy thing. But it definitely helped me. Helped me grow, understand the need to push yourself and to surround yourself with people who are going to challenge you. And I think that's kind of been something I've been chasing, trying to do ever since then.
Bryce, what is your leadership style? If a teammate makes an error or mistake and they come back to the huddle, what are you going to say to them?
Yeah, I think it all depends on circumstance, it all depends on player, it all depends on, what the moment is. If it's a big game, you kind of have to know the player. If it's someone that responds well to a challenge and yelling at them, you have to do that. And if it's someone who responds better to like positive reinforcement or whatever it may be, I think it's important. As a leader, two things I think are really important is, one, make sure you're leading by example. People aren't going to believe you if you're saying something that you're not doing, you're not upholding. So you have to make sure when you are telling someone what to do, or you're trying to lead, that you are able to, you know, you're able to walk the walk, you're able to do it as well. And you have to earn that respect from the people, from people that you're around first. You know, you have to make sure that you earn the respect of people around you in order to, you know, or in order to lead. And also, you know, just to make sure that, again, everyone kind of has a different leadership style and everyone is different. So you have to know the people that you're around or people you're meeting. And, you know, if it's maybe a big, if it's a game and a big moment in the game, it's probably more so just next one, keep it going. If you feel like someone's being lazy in practice, and it's just an effort thing, maybe that's more what you have to get after someone. So, you know, you have to, it's all, you kind of have to, it's all circumstantial. You kind of have to gauge the room and figure out on a case-by-case basis.
What did you learn from Mac last year? What have you learned from
Saban? Yeah, I learned a lot from Mac. For me, being as a freshman new to college, you know, Mac being there, being such an experienced veteran leader, having an amazing season like he did, for that being my intro kind of to college football, I mean, I couldn't have asked for a better, you know, introduction to the sport. And for him to have all the success that he did, for the team to have all the success that they did last year, for me to be able to sit back and get a front row seat to what it took and behind the scenes of it, to see all the preparation, all the hard work, the attitude, the leadership that that group had, that Mac had, for me to kind of understand, you know, for me to understand the standard that we set at the university, it helped me develop tremendously and be under Coach Saban and learn from him. Again, that's someone who, who's you know, greatest coach to do it. He's been, you know, he's seen everything, been in every situation, you know, understand everything. And for him to just, whether it's him calling you into his office and talking about how you carry yourself, or talking X's and O's on the field, about little tips about whether it be coverage things, protection things. And he's someone who is, I mean, he's super wise, has all the knowledge in the world. And anytime I can pick his brain, anytime he wants to give, you know, he gives me a tip or give me a pointer. Whether it maybe be him putting me aside on the sideline and talking about anything, you know, just me being able to hang on to